morning, friends. Welcome back to my channel, or welcome if you're new. My name is Mel, and today I bring you another 48-hour readathon vlog with my most ambitious TBR to date. 7 books on my TBR, and while I have read this amount before in 48 hours, I have never put this amount into a TBR. However, I'm confident, I'm ambitious, I want to read, which is the most important part. So as you guys would know, you'd be no stranger to the fact that every single month I do host a 24-hour readathon alongside some of my friends, and every single month for the past few months, I've been turning it into a 48-hour event for me, and then the Citadel joins me and my friends sometimes join me too. So I am absolutely excited to see how we do this time around, and my TBR might be a little bit too ambitious this time around considering the fact that I literally got vaccinated yesterday and I've been sleeping and very out of energy for the past 24 hours. So I don't know how this is gonna go, but we're going to hope for the best today. So for my TBR this time around, I have 7 books, and let me start with the shorter ones. I do have mangas in here, which is why it's so heavy. But the first book I do plan to read this weekend is A Worthy Opponent by Katie Robert. Now, you guys know I've been reading the Wicked Villain series and having the best time, just because the girl is in some dire need of smut and nonsense, honestly, because these books are straight up porno plot. So in this one, we follow Tinkerbell and Hook. Besides that, I really don't know anything. I don't read the synopses of these books before going into them. After that, I have Tokyo Ghoul Volume 3. I have been dying to read this, and every single time I put it off. I loved Volume 1, Volume 2 was incredible as well, and now it's time to dive into Volume 3. We follow Ken Kaneki, who is a college student, and all he wants to do is ask the girl he likes out and for her to like him back, except that he soon finds out that she is actually a ghoul, and ghouls are creatures that are stalking the earth at the moment and feasting on human flesh, and that is where the story goes. It's super crazy, the world is fantastic, it's super action-packed, I love the art for it. Naturally, we've got more manga in here because I've been craving some manga recently, and that is a sign of affection. This is a josei, I believe, because the back says that this is for ages 16 and up. And we have Yuki, who is our main character, and she is very much into beauty and fashion, and she has a chance encounter with a really beautiful boy on the train. And this encounter leads to a serious crush, except that she doesn't know if he can return those feelings for her. And because of the main books that I'm reading for this readathon, I think I'm gonna need some cuteness in here, so this is in here for those purposes. Then I do have Death Note, and I'm gonna be reading Volume 2 because Volume 1 has already been read, and I am so excited to see and kind of refresh my mind as to how the series goes. In Death Note, we follow Light Yagami, and he finds this really strange notebook that literally fell from the sky, and soon enough he finds out that this notebook contains the power of a Shinigami, so every name that he writes in this Death Note will essentially be killed off in whatever way he commands, and he will face a lot of struggles along the way with police investigations and a super incredible detective by the name of L. And then for the main books of this TBR, I do have the book that I'm currently reading, and that is Thunderhead by Neil Schusterman, and it is finally here. It is finally time. I am tabbing this. I am loving this. I finally picked this up after a year of reading and loving Scythe, and we established this world where every struggle that humankind has faced for the past few years is basically riddled. The only one that remains is overpopulation, and the only way that they figured out how to eradicate this, or to rather keep it as controlled as they could, is to create this organization called the Scythedom, and the individuals who partake in this organization are called Scythes, and they have the power and the duty, and they are basically the law as to how and when people will get killed. And we particularly follow Citra and Rowan as they both enter their apprenticeship with the Scythedom, and they learn the ins and outs of this world and how it's really more corrupt than meets the eye. And then I have 2 more books, and the first one is Percy Jackson and the Lightning Thief. I put this in last month's TBR and I didn't get around to it, but now that I have these babies, it is time for me to dive back in and just read this and love this. I do have my Camp Half-Blood giant bookmark in here, and I am just so excited to dive back into the Percy world, read a middle grade in a readathon. I think it'll be really fun, and just relish in these vibes because they're needed at the moment. And then last but not least, I have a thriller, and this is the only book, I believe, based on how my TBR is going right now, that I'm gonna be audiobooking, because I will absolutely need a break. My eyes will need a break. So that is The Silent Patient by Alex Michaelides. I know everybody loves this thriller. They say it's like super twisty and like messed up, and like all I know about this is that we follow a famous painter and her husband, who is a famous photographer, and one day he arrives back home and she literally shoots him in the face. I know, that's literally what the synopsis says. I don't know anything else beside this. We'll see if I actually manage to read all of them. If I don't, that's totally okay, but I just like to have some laid out options for myself throughout the 24 hours. I shall chat with you guys in a minute. So I am here to give you an update. It's not the update I was hoping for, but it's an update nonetheless. So I have been reading Thunderhead ever since the readathon started. I am currently on page 170. So I have read more than 100 pages by now, and I am still very much enjoying this. I'm having like the greatest time ever. And I definitely am hoping to finish this before the next set of sprints at 11 a.m. However, I literally just watched episode 1 of a Taiwan class and I am traumatized. I thought I was gonna watch a cute K-drama. That is not what I got in that first episode. So I need something happy right now because I can't read about this after watching that. I don't know if a girl can handle all this heaviness. I'm gonna jump into A Sign of Affection just for like a cute little moment. As for Thunderhead, as to how this is going, I think what messes me up the most about this series is the fact that it really makes you question how humanity has all of these tools and all of these ways to get rid of every single issue that we already have as a society, as humanity, as beings living in this planet, and how we have all of the tools right in front of us to kind of right all of those wrongs, yet we don't do it because we're either not brave enough or because we don't have the right people in leadership to do that. And it's super crazy to read about it from like this perspective and to kind of see the Thunderhead take care of all of these things that are so complicated, and they're so like, there are so many things that are convoluted in the series because it's not as simple as like good and evil or like right from wrong. It's super ominous to, instead of having scythe notes or like journal entries in this one, we have Thunderhead entries. See this sentient being talk to us, explain and detail out its thought process into how it's gone about the things that it has the way that it has. And I also really like what the book is establishing in terms of corruption. I think that is one of the bigger themes that we saw in book one. And in this one, it's kind of interesting because instead of seeing it firsthand with like an individual who is being corrupt, we kind of see the action of the corruptness being delegated onto somebody else, and then people justifying the act by saying, it is not me who's doing it. It is not my blade. It is not my hand. It is not my call. It is somebody else who's carrying out the motion, and therefore you can't blame me. I am innocent of this crime. Even if it's not you doing the motion and you're still doing it by somebody else's hand, it still is corruption. And I think the characters are all doing a very good job at acknowledging that, or at least Citra and Rowan are, and I really like them. I just love Citra and Rowan so much, and I really love the way that Citra is going about a lot of things in this book, even down to, I'm not obviously gonna say like specific things in order to like not spoil book one, but the way that she's going about her business in this book, not only does it show a lot of compassion, but it also shows a lot of kindness in an act that is not, again, inherently good or evil, but that there's a lot of gray area in, and that a lot of people have been mishandling for years. And it's super refreshing to see Citra's perspective on all of this and kind of see her take a different route in this landscape in a way where it could change the future of the world how they see it. As always, these Thunderhead passages are messing me up even more than the scythe ones. Oh, let me see if I can find one. In fact, I have never killed or even harmed a single human being. Therefore, although I do not require devotion, am I not deserving of it? And it really makes you wonder if we ever do reach this point of there is no wrongs in the world anymore, what will happen? Will things still look the same, but even more hidden? And it's honestly so worrisome in a way to read these things and be put into this perspective. It is so wild, but I am loving every single second of Thunderhead. I am gonna read A Sign of Affection and then I'm gonna go back to Thunderhead, so I shall update you guys when I have more updates. update. I'm doing this standing up because I am running the risk of falling asleep if I do this sitting down. I am about to take my makeup off and take a nap. I don't know if you guys can see it. You probably can, but I'm tired. I can barely keep my eyes open. However, I do have two updates for you guys. I started and finished A Sign of Affection, and it really was super cute. It was really cute to see the main character kind of struggle between figuring out her feelings and kind of differentiating what is affection and a crush versus love, and kind of her whole battle with it right from the start. I will say that, like, the start, it literally throws you into the story, super fast-paced, super insta-lovey, which I typically don't mind with, like, Shoujo or Josei, because I know that's typically what they do. And I am still trying to figure out, based on this one volume, what the male love interest is feeling, if he's really interested, if he's just being friendly. I don't think it gave me enough info as to what's happening surrounding these characters or in these characters' minds, except Yuki, for me to thoroughly understand and love the story. Because truly all that we see is her being like, oh my god, I really like him. Oh my god, did I say the wrong thing? Why hasn't he texted me back? Should I text him back and, like, touch base? And so it's basically that over and over again. And seeing her dynamic communicating with people being deaf, which that part I really, really love. And so while I didn't have enough info, it was still really fun. And I think it was the buffer book that I needed before jumping back into Thunderhead. So that was nice. I rated it 4 stars still. And I think volume 2 will definitely be better. I think depending on how volume 2 goes, I might lower my rating for this. But I definitely think volume 2 will be better, hopefully. And then for my second update, I am officially 50% into Thunderhead. I am exactly on page 256, so literally exactly smack down the middle of the book. This book is way longer than I expected it to be. I don't know why I thought this book was like 400 pages, and I'm like, I got this. But I mean, I still got this, but it'll definitely take me a little bit longer. Hopefully I'll finish this by the end of Kristen Sprints at 11 a.m. I would say it's giving me like 4-star feels. Definitely not loving this more than Scythe. Especially the more I read, there's definitely parts that I don't care about. I think the storyline with Slade, with Grayson, you know, he has two names, I really don't find myself caring too much about what is going on with the Unsavories. And while some of it is interesting because it's providing a lot of world building, I still am not, like, hooked on those chapters, and I kind of just want to skim through them, even though I'm holding myself back from doing that. But I definitely don't care about that storyline as I do Citra's or Rowan's or whatever is happening with, like, the Scythe Dom aside from the Unsavories. And what I will say, something very original about this book that I'm really loving, is that a lot of the world building is being conveyed through those Thunderhead notes, and the way that it does it, it's like, you feel for the Thunderhead. Like, you feel for the sentient being that almost represents, again, like, this godlike figure, this figure that just fixed every wrong that humanity had. And the way that the Thunderhead wants to fit in a way where it cannot, it's really heartbreaking to read about. There was definitely one passage, I just don't remember what page it was on, but it definitely freaking broke my heart reading it, about basically how humankind created the Thunderhead, and even though they are made of the same thing, or it was made by this, you know, ruling entity of the world, they are still not the same. And oh, how it yearns to be. And it's really crazy how you feel for essentially an AI. It's like really crazy how much you sympathize with the Thunderhead as you read the book. We already got a little bit of foreshadowing slash info into the third book, The Toll. Now it's starting to make more sense to me as to what that book is gonna be about. That is it for now. I really need to take off my makeup, which I was trying new products today, and they held off really, really nicely. I cannot keep my eyes open for much longer. It's time to sleep. I'm excited for some sleep. I'm asleep for 2 hours, just 2. So we'll see if I can actually pull through and only sleep for 2. But the couch, we looking comfy right now. Hello, good morning. I'm awake. It is 8:20 a.m. in the morning, so I am right on time. I said that the latest I was gonna wake up was 8:30. So it is time to go back to reading. I am gonna pick up Thunderhead, read a little bit more of that, and see where that takes me, and then figure it out from there. But I am gonna go back to Miss Thunderhead. These little hairs, it's fine. Fine. We're doing great, sweetheart. But yeah, I'm gonna pick up Thunderhead again, and then you're from near.
page 300. Page 300 of this book. Are you kidding me?
You guys, no.
Just as I was getting a little bit bored, Mr. Schusterman decides to drop that in page 300. I don't like it. I don't like it. I'm out of breath. I was not expecting that in page 300. I was not expecting that. Oh my freaking God. Okay, I need to go back to reading. Holy shit, you guys. Oh my God. You guys, this freaking quote. What the hell? You know what? I'm gonna read the whole thing. The whole thing. Oh wow. I can communicate in 6,909 living and dead languages. I can have more than 15 billion simultaneous conversations and be fully engaged in every single one. I can be eloquent and charming, funny and endearing, speaking the words you most need to hear at the exact moment you need to hear them. Yet even so, there are unthinkable moments where I can find no words in any language, living or dead. And in those moments, if I had a mouth, I might open it to scream.
Wow. 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 Oh my God. This book is so freaking, like, see, it's moments like these where I go, I'm a little bit bored, or I'm starting to enter like boredom territory, and then this is dropped. That is so good. And it's like right beside page 300 too, so right that, oh wow. Oh, I just love the way that whatever is written in these Thunderhead notes comes back in the next chapter, and you have a full circle moment. It's just so well executed. It's crazy. Like sometimes you read the Thunderhead notes and you really don't know where the story is going and how it's going to correlate to whatever is going to follow next. And then the chapter happens and it absolutely makes every bit of sense. So it gives you added context to what's about to happen. I am in love with this. I love this. It's giving me an existential crisis, but I'm here for it.
If I have any words, I just finished Thunderhead. Those last 100 pages, violence, sadness. I'm wow. And we didn't even, oh my God, and we didn't even, oh my God. I'm definitely gonna put this whole in my August DVR, and I love this for me. But holy crap, was this ending freaking fantastic. I don't know if I can say anything else because it'd obviously be a spoiler, but just know, this is a 4-star. Like, there were definitely parts that I did not care about and parts that I was definitely bored at. But like overall, I think it was a really strong book, a really strong follow-up to an already incredible first installment, and I already know the toll is going to be absolute insanity. I'm a little bit scared because I know not everybody loves the toll, but based on how this book ends, it's gonna be a crazy, crazy book, and I'm in horrifying awe of how cruel humanity can be. And what happened at the end, it's both shocking, but I understand why that decision was made. I just have to say, go Thunderhead.
Wow, go freaking Thunderhead.
I think I need to cool down and take a little bit of a break.
Okay, so I've just come into the room and I'm trying to look at my options right now. So I have two mangas left. So I've got Death Note Volume 2 and then Tokyo Ghoul Volume 3. Or I could do some smut, but I'm really not feeling the smut right now, so I really don't think I'm gonna read that. And then I have like two full-blown books, but I think right now I'm in like dire need of like an audiobook, so I think I am going to start The Silent Patient and slowly start chipping away at it, because I think we have like 7 more hours till the next sprint, so it's definitely more than enough time to finish this and then hopefully maybe read like the two mangas that I have left and then move on to whatever else. I kind of need to just sit down and read with my ears, just listen to it and not really read with my eyes. Probably not the greatest idea to go from one shocking book to another shocking book, but in this household apparently we're thriving in pain right now, so might as well just keep that pain going and then jump into the wholesomeness that is Percy Jackson and then some cool down smut. Thank you. are we doing? This is me updating on The Silent Patient. I have been reading this basically all afternoon. I've been trying to listen as nonstop as I possibly can. I'm not gonna lie, I have fallen asleep 3 times, had to rewind 3 times. I also ate some food, so it's just been a really long afternoon. I don't know if having a readathon right after getting vaccinated was a great idea. I am definitely feeling exhausted. Like, I feel like I have no energy left to give. I am currently on page 190 of The Silent Patient, but I thought this was gonna be like groundbreaking right from the start. I was gonna be like so engaged in the story, and it also might be the audiobook because I am completely audiobooking this book, but I am not connecting with the story as much as I thought I would. I am not even trying to play detective. It might also be because I'm really tired, so it might be a combination of things, but honestly, there's just not been a lot of moments in this book that have wowed me so far. I am gonna try my best to, with the remainder of the book, to follow along as best as I can with my eyes. I think, however, the concept is really interesting about having this wife that murdered her husband in seemingly cold blood. And I think it was really chilling to read that one scene when the police officers literally walk in and they find Alicia just standing in the middle of her living room, just drenched in blood. The house is drenched in blood. Her husband is dead on the floor, and there is absolutely no explanation as to what happened. Now, what I do find interesting about that one scene is that the police officers ruled the crime scene as there was too much blood for it to only be one person's. So I am really questioning whether her husband is really dead, and my mind is going to like the craziest of places. And no matter how much Theo is trying to make Alicia open up, she is not having any of it. She is literally not opening up at all. And what I didn't expect, though I should have, because I really didn't know what direction this book was gonna take, is for the book to have been told from the perspective of the psychotherapist that is trying to make Alicia open up. I definitely didn't expect that, and to also have so much background into his story with his wife, Kathy. There was one scene that did crack me up, though it was really messed up, and it was how he had found out that his wife, Kathy, was actually emailing with this dude called Bad Boy 22, 26. I can't even remember the number anymore. And then nasty ass references like, I still have your smell on me. Like, oh my god, it was disgusting. And so when it comes to stuff like that, I'm just trying to figure out how that's relevant to this story, because again, I've been kind of loopy listening to the audiobook, and I've just been trying to figure out how this is important to the story being a filler moment. I just really want it to come full circle. I again will try my bestest to follow along with the actual physical book as I read the last bit of this, because I just need it all to make sense. Right now I paused the audiobook in a part where I feel we're gonna start having some revelations as to exactly what happened that night, because there's a person right now, I think it's one of Alicia's friends, who actually kind of knows what's happening, who confided in her. So hopefully she provides some insights that Alicia will not. There have also been Alicia kind of journal entries, and those have been really chilly as well. And you can tell that she was definitely standoffish and afraid of the current landscape in which she was living in. And I just kind of want to see, I want to see more of that. I want to see how we got there. I want to see more context. And I don't know if it's because I've just, you know, again, been super tired that I feel we haven't gotten a lot of that. Like, this book has been a lot about Mr. Psychotherapist. But yeah, I will go back to reading. We do have the last set of sprints in a little bit, so hopefully, I know I'll finish it during sprints, but, or at least get through the majority of it during sprints. So wish me luck. We'll figure it out. Those are my theories. And then, for the record, I was right.
guys. So this lighting is a little bit weird because the ring light is on that side. I'm filming on this side, but good morning. Hello. I totally fell asleep yesterday after the last set of sprints. I was so freaking tired. I thought I was gonna be able to keep reading some more like I did last time's readathon. I couldn't. I was so tired. I crashed. I woke up today literally just in time for Citadel sprints, and even then I almost didn't make it, and then my Wi-Fi started giving me troubles. It's been a morning. However, I do have two updates for you guys. I ended up finishing The Silent Patient last night, and this was the last thing I read before I went to bed. The audiobook for this at the very end, I will take back and eat my words and say it's not the audiobook's fault. It was definitely my fault that I wasn't paying enough attention because it was so good. I think to me at least, the first half of the book was not nearly as interesting as the second half of the book. I think from the last point that I updated you guys up until the end, also because I was trying real hard to stay concentrated on what was happening in the story, I enjoyed every single second of what was happening. And I think it was really interesting to kind of see the parallels and how it all connects at the end of Theo's life and his life with Kathy and then Alicia's life with Gabriel. I think it was so well done. And even if things seem like they don't have a purpose in the story, it does. It's definitely a hard book to talk about. I was talking about this with Ashley yesterday, who's like one of my patrons, how hard it is to talk about The Silent Patient without giving anything away, because the more that you talk about the book, the less impactful and shocking it'll be for people. And that being said, I ended up rating it a 4-star, and it was a big turn of events because I didn't think it was gonna be anywhere near a 4-star based on like the first half of the book. I think if I had been paying more attention, I probably would have enjoyed it more, like that first half. That second half definitely made up for whatever I was feeling there. The twist in this book, you guys, it's just really wild to think about the fact that people like this like really are out there, and that things like these actually happen out in the real world. And that was my very last theory at the start of part 4. I was like, okay, one last theory, just for shits and giggles, just for the sake of saying that I have a theory, put it out there, sent it on the Discord. And then I didn't think I was gonna be right based on people's reactions, and then I was right. And even if I was right, hearing the motif and hearing the reasoning and hearing how it all went down was even crazier than what I imagined in my head. So even if I knew what was gonna happen, it was hella shocking. So there's that. Those are my last few thoughts on The Silent Patient. But the other update that I have is that I read and finished Tokyo Ghoul Volume 3. This was also a 4-star. So by the looks of it, this is gonna be the reading vlog of 4 stars, because everything so far has been a 4-star. And Tokyo Ghoul is one of those mangas that the illustrations really freak me out, especially Mado. Mado really scares the crap out of me. Like every time he warps his face and he starts looking all crazy and like deranged, it really scares the crap out of me. And I love it because it adds to that element of horror that this manga is supposed to have. I also really liked the element of world building that we got in this one, just as the second one. The second one was like full of world building. In this one, I think we get a little bit more explanation and a little bit world expansion, not necessarily from the ghoul's perspective, but from the human's perspective, and how they go about defending themselves, how they go about ghoul investigations, and how they set up their equipment in order to snitch out some ghouls. It's just really interesting to see how the world has prepared and warded themselves against these creatures and how it discriminates them so much. And I wonder if this is supposed to be social commentary as well, because in a way it does feel like it, because characters keep repeating like the world is wrong, like you guys don't belong, you guys shouldn't exist, the world is not for you, we want to kill you off, you're dangerous. And scarily enough, it's so close to what I know certain countries experience with people of color, and so it's just really scary to look at it in this landscape and to kind of see how it correlates to regular life, because it really is crazy. But I really enjoyed this one too, and it was also really sad with Hinami's story, obviously given the events of volume 2, and just seeing the theme of grief in here and how it's hard to get past it. For as much as you have support systems around you, like everybody will go through different journeys, and it'll be easier for some people, it'll be harder for others, and it's such an individual journey. It's just really heartbreaking to see where some of these characters are at in volume 3. And it was also really interesting to see Toka's need for validation in a way, because we see a different side of her here, where obviously she has like this really tough skin and she
has this facade of that she's super strong and that she doesn't care. But in this one, we see a side, especially with Hinami, where she is constantly wondering, why not me? Why not come to me? Why not talk to me? Why not ask me? And that really speaks to her character and I guess why she has such tough skin, because she is constantly, in a way, I guess, comparing herself to others. And we obviously see that a little bit with the dialogue that she has, because obviously since it's not written in prose, this is just me kind of expanding on what I see. And it was really interesting to see that side of her in this one, because I guess the way that it comes across is that she would potentially feel second to Ken, especially in Hinami's life right now. And that was really interesting to see.
Okay, so I have chosen my next read, and that is Smut. So I am going to be reading A Worthy Opponent, and we shall see where this takes me. I read some Goodreads reviews, and people said that out of all the books that they had read so far, this one had a good amount of plot. So hopefully it does, because I really don't know what to expect. I hope that the smut is on par with the second book, which was fantastic.
Hello. I completely gave up on updating yesterday because I was just feeling super sluggish, super tired. Those basically mean the same thing. And today I was just like, you know what? Let's extend the readathon unofficially to the Monday, update the vlog, finish the book that I still have to finish, and then wrap up my final thoughts. So let's update you guys. So in terms of updates, I have two for you guys. The first one is that I started and finished A Worthy Opponent by Katie Robert. And this book was interesting in the sense of it was not at all like the other books. And when I go into the Wicked Villain series by Katie Roberts, I mostly expect just like poor, no plot, a fun time, a lot of smut, and literally no plot, like just none. And so in this one, we encounter a book that is, yes, has smut, but it has smut in an unconventional way, I'd say. Because this book is supposed to be about Tink and Hook, and even if the story is supposed to be centered around them, I'm not gonna lie, I felt like the people who got laid the most together were Hook and Gaston, and not Hook and Tink. Look, I'm down for anything that Katie Robert wants to write, but if the book is supposed to be about them, give me most of the smut with them too. And I get why she didn't do it too, which is kind of like the counterbalance to that argument, because this book was more so about the emotional connection, going past trauma that has been living inside us for a long time, and kind of healing and overcoming everything that has been tearing us apart internally. I don't know if I like the way that it was done in this book, because I don't feel like it was justified enough, and I also don't feel like the development warranted that. I feel like this book explained healing through revenge, and while I typically don't mind books like that, I don't think I've ever read anything quite like it either, but I feel like I wouldn't really mind it as long as the resolve was something like, oh yeah, I wanted revenge and even that cannot heal me. But in this book, it's like I got my revenge and that's why I feel okay. And also through somebody else, like somebody else is making me better instead of myself wanting to get better and seek the help that I need. So I don't know
if I vibe with the way that Katie Robert went about that. And I think anytime I approach a book that it's supposed to be something and then it incorporates the themes of mental health and trauma in a setting that not necessarily complements it very well, I don't think I love that. It's the same thing I encountered with the, oh my god, what was it called? Undercover Bromance. And so while I wanted to love this for obvious reasons, I couldn't, and I rage rated this 2 stars. So I was indeed in the mood for Percy Jackson and the Lightning Thief, and to nobody's surprise, it is going extremely well. I read this way back when. I read this around the time that the movie had come out. As you guys would know if you've been here for a while, I do have the movie tie-in edition, so that's how you know that I read it around that time. And I have been wanting to go back to the Percy world for such a long time, especially because I really want to finish the Heroes of Olympus series, but I really want to just read them linearly. So reading the entirety of the Percy Jackson and the Olympian series, and then going into the Heroes of Olympus, and then going into Magnus Chase, and just read them all kind of like in order. And also I really want to get to the Trials of Apollo soon. Yesterday I also went on this rabbit hole of looking at all of the Rick Riordan Presents books. I did start this, and I am currently on page 202, and I just freaking love this so much. And I love the way that Rick Riordan, is it Rick Riordan or Rick Riordan? I always say Riordan. That's probably wrong, isn't it? Anyway, I love the way that he starts his books. I never finished The Red Pyramid, but this starts very similarly to that, or rather that one starts similarly to this because this came out first. And it starts like a letter to the reader, and I just love that ominous feeling of like, if you're reading this, beware, thereafter you stop reading, hide yourself, protect yourself. It's like that frantic feeling that when I was a kid, I was like, oh my god, I'm a demigod, oh my god. Like, I genuinely bought into it, and I got scared, and I remember putting the books down because I was like, oh my god, I'm not supposed to be reading this. And so I think it's a really engaging way to present these sorts of books to kids and to make them really engaged with the story. And what I really enjoy about the Percy Jackson series, and I mean anything that Rick Riordan has put out, like, I feel fits the mold of, it is super accurate to the mythology it is drawing inspiration from or that it's centered around. But I think despite the fact that this is for kids, it does a really great job at sticking to what we know. And so I find it so incredibly interesting still. And I, reading this now, I'm like, no wonder I got into mythology, because this is so great. And it's such a, oh, I don't even know how to explain it. It's the best way to kind of get you kickstarted into that world. I love, obviously, because it's middle grade, how he makes it so digestible for the reader, where no matter the age, you'll still probably get something out of it. And Percy as a main character, I think to nobody's surprise, like, he is so lovable, and you feel for him so much throughout the story. And I think what I like the most about Percy's character and all of the half-bloods, because most half-bloods, if not all of them, they all have ADHD and they have dyslexia, and it's because their brains are wired for ancient Greek, they're not wired for English. And what I really like about that, and there was a passage right towards the start of the book where he was talking about Chiron, and he was basically saying how Chiron expected the most out of Percy, and he expected excellence, and he expected more out of him than the others, and how despite his ADHD and dyslexia, Mr. Bruner, Chiron, never really put him down, and he always again expected the best from Percy. And Percy is constantly putting himself down because he has ADHD and because he has dyslexia. And I really like, I guess, the way that Rick Riordan goes about it, in a way where he leaves it pretty blatant that ADHD and dyslexia do not hold you back from doing regular things. In fact, you can be excellent, you are excellent, you can still strive for greatness and be great. You are great. And I love how empowering it is for specifically kids growing up with ADHD and dyslexia, reading a book like this, where it feels like you can tackle the whole world and just be a hero and accomplish anything that you set out to do. And I really like that. And also, obviously, because it's still so stigmatized in certain countries and in certain areas, it's looked at, you're less than. And I love the reinforcement of, you are not less than, you are equally as good, if not better. And I really love that. It made me tear up rereading that part where he was talking about Mr. Bruner and how Mr. Bruner really just treats him like a regular kid because there's no other way to treat him. Like, honestly, it's really beautiful. I am loving every second of this. It's super exciting as well. I love this, and I can't believe it took me this long to pick it back up and love this and read this and tab it and annotate it. I'm having the best time, and I will definitely put The Sea of Monsters into my August TBR because I am ready to fly through these books and just read them.
Welcome to the very last update of this 48-hour readathon vlog turned unexpectedly into a 72-hour readathon vlog, because at the end I ended up reading basically the entirety of Monday since I don't work Mondays, and I actually ended up finishing not one, but two books. And if you couldn't already guess, I did finish Percy Jackson and the Lightning Thief and Percy Jackson and the Sea of Monsters. So I read the first and the second book in the Percy Jackson series. I couldn't hold myself back from reading these, and I just had a fantastic time reading these two. When I tell you guys that I knew I missed the Percy Jackson world, I just didn't know how much up until I started reading these. It's no joke. I flew through both books. They were so exciting. I love the camaraderie, the found family, the finding a space for yourself that is not necessarily what you used to call home, finding yourself in the midst of all of the craziness and adversities of life. It's honestly a fantastic journey to go on with Percy. He is such a fantastic young boy. And don't get me started on Annabeth. Annabeth is one of my favorite characters for a number of reasons. I think the way that she was written definitely breaks. Let me just put these books down because I'm gonna be here talking for a minute. I think that the way that Annabeth was written in a way where, because she is super smart and blonde, it kind of broke that stereotype in books that we used to witness a lot, where obviously the blonde girl could not be smart at the same time, which is such an unrealistic and false stereotype that society has created. And I just love that Annabeth kind of breaks all of those stereotypes and reinvents herself and reinvents this narrative, this rhetoric that has been around for so long. And I really love that for like young girls out there. I think it's really empowering, just as Percy is. And I am constantly in awe of how Mr. Uncle Rick really wrote these characters and this story, because it's beautiful. In the second book especially, introducing Tyson, not only is Tyson one of the funniest characters in the series, but also one of the most empathetic and just genuinely human characters. And even though his journey with Percy and with the people around him was not the easiest, I really enjoyed seeing Percy's journey with embracing who Tyson really was and looking past the prejudice and looking past the hatred and the embarrassment and the awkwardness and just embracing somebody else no matter who they are. Again, there's just beautiful lessons in here, not only because the story merits it, but also because it's middle grade. And I just truly enjoy every single second of this series. I can't wait to move on with it. But all I want to do right now is just binge the rest of the series, so I might go ahead and do that. We'll see where the days take me, because honestly, after reconnecting with Percy, it's like, how can I go back to a life without it? Like, I can't. I just need to finish my reread of all of these books. And as for ratings for both of these books, I gave The Lightning Thief 5 stars, and then I gave Sea of Monsters 5 stars. No shame, no shame. There's no shame in this household. So yes, you guys, I hope that you enjoyed this next round in our monthly readathons. This time around, I did it a little bit longer than expected, but honestly, again, after getting vaccinated, the only thing I wanted to do was just kind of rest and recharge. So yeah, make sure to give this video a thumbs up if you enjoyed it, and subscribe down below if you haven't already. I'm constantly uploading videos that I'm sure you do not want to miss. And comment down below if you've read any of these books. What did you think of them? Let me know all of that down in the comments. What did you guys read this time around for the readathon? If you participated, if you didn't participate, what did you read this weekend? And if you reached the very end of the video, let's leave some sea emojis down below in honor of Mr. Percy. He deserves all the sea emojis if you reach the very end. And if you want more exclusive content, more exclusive videos, exclusive live streams, early access to videos, a book club, buddy reads, a Discord server, a podcast, journaling content, everything in between, I do have a Patreon. We call ourselves The Citadel. And like always, that is linked down below alongside all of my social medias. So if you do want to check any of them out, they're always linked down below. And yeah, I love you guys so much, and I shall see you on the next one. Bye, guys.